Gospel of Mark is showing us not only a different view of the Messiah, a suffering Messiah, but is also showing us that with the gospel, it is the end of how the Jewish people or Israelites had configured their religion. And this is the big difference where Jews and Christians separate. For us, Jesus is the way we come to God, not through any temple anymore. That's why in Gospel of John, he puts it differently. Gospel of John, this action, by the way, is given in the second chapter. Some people have mistakenly thought Jesus cleansed the temple twice. No. Because it mentions earlier in John. None of the Gospels are really doing it chronologically. But John is trying to emphasize. He says, Jesus in Gospel of John says, destroy this temple and I will rebuild it in 3 days. So in other words, from then on, the temple is not this building anymore. Jesus. And Apostle Paul, when he writes to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17, he's telling them the church, not the body there. Chapter 3 is, don't you know that you are the temple? When Paul is saying that, it may be around 55 AD, the temple is still there in Jerusalem. While the temple is in Jerusalem, he's saying, you are the temple. That temple has no value anymore for Christians. Of course, you know that in the book of Acts, they walked into the temple and prayer, all that was there. But the value of that temple is limited now because Jesus has become the way to enter into the presence of God. Christians don't sacrifice or do anything anymore in any other temple. Jesus is our sacrifice. That's a very, very important lesson we find. Finally, we come to the last section here. The final section of Mark has three parts: the preparation, the crucifixion, and the resurrection. So the preparation for the crucifixion, we see many interesting things. In the Gospel of Mark, you have a woman who anoints Jesus. Who is this woman? And by the way, this woman receives the highest commendation from Jesus. No disciple has got this commendation, including the words, wherever the gospel is preached, what you have done will be talked about it. She has done a beautiful thing, right? Who's this woman? In the Gospel of Mark, she's an unknown woman. And it's not Mary Magdalene that sometimes we make the mistake. In Luke's Gospel, chapter 7, you have a woman who anoints Jesus. Who is that? Luke 7, there's a sinful woman who anoints Jesus. Who is that? Again, the name is not given. Let's never assume it is Mary Magdalene. But that is another mistake we do sometimes, just assume it is Mary Magdalene. Gospel of John chapter 12 talks about Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus. That is Gospel of John. But here is an unknown woman, unnamed woman. Beautiful story, who pours out her offering. Is a 1 year's offering. It's like what a person earns over a year, she puts it in one offering. What a generosity, what a love. What a sacrifice. What a beautiful picture of the lavish love of our disciple. Then in that story, you also find Judas, unfortunately, failing terribly at this time. And then Jesus has a final Passover celebration with his disciples, chapter 12. And the very meal which symbolized what Jesus was about to do as a suffering servant. So that Passover feast should remind us, every time we have a Lord's Supper, it should remind us that this reminds us that Jesus was a suffering servant and we are called to be suffering servants. And then you have Peter's denial predicted and then the story of Gethsemane. So that's the first section. The second section is Jesus is arrested and tried before the religious leaders, the Sanhedrin. For the first time in his public ministry, he acknowledges that he is the Christ. In this acknowledgement, he speaks of his power and glory and not his servanthood. He was brought to Pilate, where once again he affirmed that he was a king of the Jews. His kingdom was plainly seen as not belonging to this world. In an ironic twist of history, this Pilate, who represented Roman might, was powerless to prevent the execution of Christ. True greatness and power were being redefined in the cross. So the cross of Jesus, the suffering of Jesus, is a thing that is highlighted in the Gospel of Mark. And finally, the Gospel closes with a brief account of the resurrection. It's very interesting when you read the Gospel of Mark, you'll say, and he was crucified, full stop. There is no mention of, you know, they beat him, then the blood was flowing from here, and then he screamed, and like we see in some of those movies. Gospel writers don't try to use the crucifixion emotionally. Interesting. He was crucified, finished. One more thing that at the end, but I want to mention, is that in the Gospel of Mark, let's read 14:50. Women, the place of women in the Gospel of Mark. 14:50, what does it say? When Jesus was arrested, everyone deserted him and fled. Everyone. 15:40 to 41. Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, the younger, and of Joseph, and Salome. There were many women, including these three. In Galilee, these women had followed him and cared for his needs. In this gospel, Jesus says, I have come to serve. And in this gospel, the only ones who are talked about as serving Jesus are these women. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. So finally, when Jesus is on the cross, major companions are women around him. Where are all the wonderful disciples? Not seen in the story. And finally, chapter 16, verses 1 to 8, we know when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus. How come the other disciples don't think of anointing the body of Jesus? The men. How come? How come women are thinking of anointing the body of Jesus? So, friends, women are shown as remaining loyal to Jesus in this gospel. So I have a question to ask you. Were there women leaders in the first century? Were there women leaders? Were there people who were like preachers, teachers, apostles? Heard of a woman apostle? No. Any woman apostle mentioned in the Bible? What are you saying, Pastor? Are there women apostles? Romans chapter 16, we're not going to have time to read all of it. 8 women are mentioned by name who are leaders in the church. They are not leaders, or their name is not mentioned because they were cooking food for the men. They are leaders, meaning they stand up and they speak and they teach all that. I must say this, and in verse 7, he says, greet Andronicus and Junia, my fellow Jews who have been in prison with me. They are outstanding among the apostles. Just like earlier, Priscilla and Aquila, we're familiar with that. 6 times they are mentioned in the New Testament, and 4 times it is Priscilla is mentioned first and Aquila is the man mentioned second. Now, it doesn't call them apostles, but you know what? They were leaders. And probably Priscilla was the leading teacher in the group, husband and wife. And Junia is mentioned here as prominent among the apostles. Now, there are some places and some translations, unfortunately, they use the word Junius. It looks like a man's name. So, study has shown that in the first century, among the Greco-Roman people, they have not found a single name of a man called Junius. But they have found 250 names of women who are called Junia. Oh, Junia is a woman's name and she's called an apostle. I personally believe, and by the way, that's the view of the Assemblies of God. Want to know what Assemblies of God believes about women in ministry? Go on to our website, ag.org, and search there for women in ministry. And they have 8 pages of notes explaining Assemblies of God does believe in ordination of women around the world. That's our faith. That is our practice. So there are more than 2,000 ordained women in America. Assemblies of God has ordained women in many, many countries, especially our neighbors, Sri Lanka and Nepal. Sri Lanka, there are women presbyters, under whom there are men. Ministry is a gift of the Holy Spirit. And my question is, does the Holy Spirit not give gifts to women or only to men? Good question. So keep thinking. I don't want to push anything more. Finally, the last story. Mark's Gospel, chapter 12, verses 41 to 44. I remember hearing this story when I was in Sunday school. Many stories. Many times you've heard this story, right? The story of the widow who gave the offering. Two coins, right? Two small coins. A widow's offering. Now tell me, what should we learn from this story? Sunday school, when we heard this story, what came to our mind? What did our Sunday school teacher say? Giving. Yeah, very good. How to give? Cheerfully. Now that is a verse from God loves a cheerful giver. You know, many of our churches' offering envelope has that verse. Do you know where that comes from? 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And do you know when Paul says give cheerfully? What is the giving he's asking for in 2 Corinthians 9? Missions. He is asking there in 2 Corinthians 9 for giving to the poor in Jerusalem, not for the church needs. I want to challenge you, if you want to use that verse, use it only for missions. Not when you're raising money to take care of the electricity and pay the bill in the church. When all the money you collect, you're going to give it out of the church to somebody else, then use that verse. That's what Paul does. I like to use it cheerfully. So, is this woman giving it cheerfully? Is that what we learn from this story? What do we learn from this story? Let's read it. Let's read the story and let's see what it says. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Think of it like 2 5-rupee coins. All she could put was 2 5-rupee coins. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on." So, what do we learn from this story? What should we teach our Sunday school children? Tell them this story. What should we teach them? Give how? How should we give? What do we do with this story? It's not about giving with all your heart. She has nothing left after she gives this. And she goes back home hungry and her children are hungry. That is not just giving with all her heart. I could give whatever and I have plenty left over. But I gave with all my heart. Correct? So what do we do? How much should we give? Tithe, 10%. That, right? Understand this story. Remember the rule of interpretation. Meanings come from the text is the key thing. So can we just read the Remember, there was no division between those verses. In my Bible, there is a heading, the widow's offering. Then there is break. So I don't read what happened before that. Let us read the previous 2-3 verses. Verses 38. As he taught, Jesus said, and now he's not being very kind, okay? He's very upset. Watch out! You know, like parents will warn their children, be very careful when you cross the road. The traffic is very, when you cross the road coming from school, be very, very careful. Watch out. Dangerous things. Watch out for whom? For whom? Teachers of the law. People who are holding scripture all the time. Watch out for them. They like to walk around in flowing robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. Watch out for those fellows. They like to dress in a way that at once shows them they are separate. And they like the honor. They like special places. Verse 40. They devour those houses. What is the meaning of devour? Swallow. Swallow widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. These men will be punished most severely. Jesus is not being very kind here. He has no toleration for these rascals. Warns his disciples, watch out for them. Religion is a show for them. They don't care even for the poor widows. They will find ways to extract even from a poor widow. They will even, if necessary, devour her house. Now, how do you eat somebody's house? How do you devour a house? A widow's, poor widow's house. How do you devour? You are a religious leader. You will not do that openly. Come and say, sister, alone, sister, you have this small house, but you know, you can write this house. Poor widow cannot pay back, they'll say sorry. Teachers of the law ready to take poor widows' houses. Getting it? What is the next story? I've shown you how to read the stories. They are all connected. Do you remember that? The blind man story, Jesus says, you disciples are blind, then the story of a blind man, then Peter, who has partial vision about the Messiah, then his blindness. You saw that connection? That's how the gospel is written. And so, this story is not a story to use in Sunday school and teach people, give like the poor widow. My God, we pray that nobody in our church is in this condition. Nobody in our church should be in this condition that they come to church and the last 5 rupee coins they have, they put it into the church, then they have no money left to take even a bus back home and they are hungry. That's not an example about giving because none of us pastors do that. We want anybody in our congregation to give like this. So this is not a story about how we can give. Illustrating what Jesus has just now said, these people swallow widows' houses. And the next story is about a widow whose house has been swallowed. Nothing to live on. What does it show, friends? A widow whose house has been devoured. But it also shows something else. Failure of God's people. The failure of the religious leaders and the community to follow the law. You see, the Old Testament scriptures are very, very clear. Religious leaders were supposed to raise money from God's people to take care of all the poor in the community. Remember the tithes? Remember the tithes in the Old Testament? There are different types of tithes. Why were tithes collected? For what? For whom? Please read the Old Testament. Clearly, in many places it says there were three groups of people the tithes were collected for, not just for Levites. And we say we are Levites, so we say tithe must come to pastor. No, it was for the Levites, then the poor in the community, widows, orphans, whoever. In the community, poor should be taken care of by God's people. Thirdly, outsiders. In other words, tithes, if we collect, they should be used for Levites. If that includes the pastor and his family, fine. But it also should take care of all the poor in our community. And also, it should go for outside missions. If God's people are doing that, this widow would not have been in this condition. Widows in Israel would have walked with their head held high and said, what a wonderful community I live in. My people, my husband died, but still, look at us, we are living well because our community takes care of us. So friends, this story is a challenge to us leaders. Take care of the needy in our churches. In our church, we have people who are really bad, and we have the ability to take care of their needs. If we fail, receive this condemnation from Jesus. Challenge to us, because we are the teachers of the law. I have one sister, she's in Bangalore. And she also comes to the church I go to. Imagine, my sister came to church and she was wearing a very shabby salwar kameez. She comes and sits in one corner. She's looking very sad. Offering bag comes and somebody sees she's putting 2 5-rupee coins. After that is over, quietly she goes off and she starts walking back home. And the other people ask, who is that lady? Oh, you don't know. Pastor Jacob's sister. Who? Pastor Jacob. He was looking very nice in a nice jacket and tie on the pulpit. Sister. He comes driving his car inside nicely and his sister walking. What will you say? How come Pastor Jacob is not taking his sister is in this condition? What kind of? By the way, the good news is sister dresses very well, drives her own car and comes to church. Thank God. Point is, when there is like God's people, he has failed. Challenging story is not an example for any of us to follow. Is the opposite. We should not allow this to happen. In our church, if there are needy people, find ways of taking care of them, because otherwise we are not law. We are not teaching in our own community. Then when God is blessing us with greater resources, we use it to bless others outside our community. Some church somewhere in Orissa or Madhya Pradesh. Our church will collect money and we will send it, right? That's what we need to do, because that is the kingdom of God. Let's summarize. What are the main things Gospel of Mark is talking about? Jesus is the servant Messiah or the suffering Messiah. Therefore, if we follow this Messiah, we have to be ready to suffer. By the way, remember that story where Jesus said after the rich man who could not follow Jesus, you know, because Jesus told him to sell everything and follow. And then Jesus says, anyone who has left his father, mother, fields, this and that, they will all receive 100-fold in this life and in the world to come, eternal life. In that passage, in Mark's gospel, there is one extra phase. You get all this along with persecutions, along with suffering. That's only in Mark's gospel. So there is a special focus in Mark's gospel on, you know why? Because the gospel is written to believe. If we preach a gospel that tells people, come to Jesus, all your suffering will be over. Gospel of Mark. Come follow me, take up your cross. Cross is suffering, including death. We are not telling people, come follow Jesus and your life will become perfect. All your sufferings will be over. No, new sufferings will come. In fact, when you start following him, he may ask you, like he did to many of us, to go to some place and give your life like a fool. Give it away. That's the gospel. Come follow me and like me, walk the way of the cross. May the Lord help us.